हेलो क्लास, आज जो टॉपिक मैं डिस्कस करने वाली हूँ दैट इज़ पेन एंड इट्स मैनेजमेंट। ये यूनिट टू मेडिकल सर्जिकल नर्सिंग में ये टॉपिक दिया हुआ है सिलेबस में। सो आई विल स्टार्ट विद द टॉपिक। फर्स्ट हम देखते हैं कि पेन का डेफिनेशन क्या होता है। सबसे ऊपर जो लिखा हुआ है इंटरनेशनल एसोसिएशन फॉर द स्टडी ऑफ पेन IASP, इसका स्टैंडर्ड डेफिनेशन दिया हुआ है जिसमें कि बताया है कि पेन इज़ ए अनप्लेजेंट सेंसरी एंड इमोशनल एक्सपीरियंस एसोसिएटेड विद एक्चुअल और पोटेंशियल टिश्यू डैमेज और डिस्क्राइब्ड इन टर्म्स ऑफ सच डैमेज। तो ये स्टैंडर्ड डेफिनेशन गिवन बाय IASP। इसी को फर्दर इलेबोरेट किया हुआ है इस डेफिनेशन को, दैट पेन इज़ ए स्टेट ऑफ फिजिकल इमोशनल और मेंटल लैक ऑफ वेलबींग और फिजिकल इमोशनल और मेंटल अनइजीनेस दैट रेंज फ्रॉम माइल्ड डिस्कम्फर्ट टू डल डिस्ट्रेस टू एक्यूट ऑफन अनबियरेबल एगोनी मे बी जनरलाइज और लोकलाइज एंड इज द कंसिक्वेंस ऑफ बींग इंजर्ड और हर्ट फिजिकली और मेंटली और ऑफ सम डिरेंजमेंट और ऑफ लैक ऑफ इक्विलिब्रियम इन द फिजिकल और मेंटल फंक्शंस एंड दैट यूजुअली प्रोड्यूसेस ए रिएक्शन ऑफ वांटिंग टू अवॉइड एस्केप और डिस्ट्रॉय द पॉजिटिव फैक्टर एंड इट्स इफेक्ट। सो पेन इज ए सेंसेशन, इट इज ए सेंसरी एक्सपीरियंस एंड पेन मीन्स दैट सम डैमेज हैज़ ऑकर्ड, आइदर एक्चुअल डैमेज हैज़ ऑकर्ड और इन नियर फ्यूचर, इन वेरी नियर फ्यूचर द डैमेज विल ऑकर। पेन इज ऑल्सो एसोसिएटेड विद फिजिकल इमोशनल एंड मेंटल स्टेट। पेशेंट फर्स्ट इन माइल्ड पेन दे कैन से दैट दे आर फीलिंग सम अनइजीनेस, देन इट विल कंटिन्यू टू माइल्ड डिस्कम्फर्ट, then it will continue to distress and ultimately severe pain can cause unbearable agony. The patient is not able to bear that pain. Next, there are certain other concepts of pain are: pain is a protective mechanism, it avoids further injury. When you are in pain, then that means the body will protect itself from any of the further injury. Pain is a subjective sensation, although some scales are available. You should remember that pain is always a subjective phenomenon. To some extent, you can measure pain with the help of certain scale. The perception of pain is highly individualized. Individual to individual, the perception of pain or the threshold of pain or the tolerance to pain is dependent. Then pain is a warning that some tissue damage has occurred, and pain is the leading cause of disability nowadays because of chronic illness, and chronic illness, most of the chronic illnesses are associated with pain. Now let us see the physiology of pain, physiological changes or physiological steps of pain, you can say. The pain is a complex mixture of physical, emotional and behavioral reactions, which I had already said in the definition. It is a physical phenomena as well as some emotions are also attached with pain, and behavioral changes or the behavioral changes will also be observed when the person is in pain. So first we will see the three physiological components are classified into three. One is reception, second is perception, third is the reaction. So how we will receive? Reception is through the some receptors which are present over the body or present over the skin. These are called as pain receptors or nociceptors. Nociceptors are certain specialized receptors or specialized receptors with nerve endings which are responding to any type of painful stimulus, any like burn, like thermal injury or chemical injury, etc. They are receptive to that. Different nociceptors may preferentially react to specific kind of noxious stimulus such as mechanical or temperature sensation. Different type of nociceptors are found in different sites, like cutaneous, that means over the skin, nociceptors are present. Over the viscera, nociceptors are present. Now next we will see in the reception part only, reception of pain. What are the different sources of pain? How pain is caused? First, mechanical cause. Mechanical means when we have either due to edema, which is causing stretching of the skin or organ, that will stimulate the nociceptors. Then stretching of narrow lumen due to stone, due to tumors, stretching will stimulate the nociceptors. Then next is chemical. Chemical means secretions which are released from a ruptured appendix or ruptured, you can say, gallbladder. From that, the chemicals which are released will irritate and the nerve endings are exposed, and these nerve endings are also stimulated, causing pain. Then third is a thermal cause. Thermal cause, like burn or extreme cold. In both cases, pain can occur, either high temperature or very low temperature. Inflammation or loss of superficial layer of epidermis. Burn and extreme cold, in both the cases, there is loss of epidermis, which will expose the nociceptor and they will cause pain sensation. The skin will be very much sensitive. Then electrical, this is also same, it will cause burn, and so the skin will be hypersensitive and patient will experience pain. Next, in the reception part or in the physiological process, you can say the brain and alveoli of the lung are insensitive to pain. There are two types of peripheral nerve fibers which conduct painful stimulus. Please remember this. One is the fast myelinated A fibers and second is the very slow unmyelinated C fibers. The fibers which are myelinated, they will carry the impulse in a very fast rate, whereas the unmyelinated fibers will carry the any type of stimulus, you can say also the pain stimulus, in a slower rate. Now we will see that actually the noxious stimulus, that means the stimulus which is causing pain, which will cause pain, they activate 10 to 20% of A delta fibers and 50 to 80% of the C fibers. That means there is slow transmission of the pain sensation. Now, A delta fibers, which I had said that A fibers are fast and myelinated. So, A delta fibers are triggered by strong mechanical pressure or intense heat. They produce fast, bright, localized pain sensation. That means response to a high temperature. If you are touching, for example, you have touched the lighted candle or you have touched a hot pressure cooker, immediately the A delta fibers will be stimulated and it will produce a fast reaction to the pain. Then C fibers are triggered by thermal, mechanical, chemical stimulus, and they will generate a more diffuse and nagging sensation. Continuously the pain will be there on activation of the C fibers, although the transmission will be quite slow compared to the A delta fibers. Then A beta fibers, this is opposite to A delta fibers and C fibers, they respond to light touch and low intensity mechanical information. they are stimulated. That means A beta fibers will be stimulated when you will rub that particular injured area. They will interrupt the nociception to the dorsal horn. That means A beta fibers inhibit the sensation of pain. Then a protective reflex also occur with pain perception, that is withdrawing from the stimulus and guarding. For example, if the viscera is injured or appendicitis, that means rupture of appendix occurs, then you will see that the guarding of the abdominal muscles occur. This is a protective mechanism to prevent further pain. So these pain fibers, the A fibers or the C fibers, these fibers enter the spinal cord through the dorsal root ganglion and terminate in the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. Normally pain sensations, they are terminated ipsilaterally and they are not, these fibers do not cross. Then we will see about some of the neurotransmitters which are released due to the stimulus, pain stimulus. First is substance P. It is a excitatory neurotransmitter, that means it will increase the pain impulse. They will transmit the pain impulse to the brain, causing vasodilatation and edema. Then serotonin. Serotonin is inhibiting the pain transmitter. So these neurotransmitters, serotonin, is released from the brain stem and dorsal horn to inhibit the pain transmission. To reduce the pain, serotonin is released. Prostaglandin, again it will increase the pain sensation, generate from the breakdown of phospholipid in cell membrane. It increases the sensitivity to pain. So some of the neurotransmitters increases the sensation of pain or increases or carry the pain impulses. Others are inhibiting the pain impulses. Next is bradykinin. This is also causing increased sensation of pain. It is released from the plasma during the leakage of site of injury and they bind to the receptors on the peripheral nerves, increasing the pain stimuli. Now second is perception and reaction to the pain. First one was the reception of pain. So second I will tell about perception and reaction to pain. How the pain stimulus is perceived by the brain and what will be the reaction. One is the physiological reaction, another will be the behavioral reaction. So how the brain perceives the pain sensation, let us see. The brain's limbic system. The limbic system helps in integrating the higher brain function with motivational and emotional reactions. So pain is associated with certain emotions, like a mother who is giving birth to a child has a positive emotional impact when she is in pain, is in labor pain. Whereas a person with a disease condition or with a terminal illness, when he is in pain, there is a negative emotional impact. So this is because of the association of the pain stimulus with the brain's limbic system. So when an injury occurs, the neural communication between the limbic system, thalamus, RF and cortex produces reactions such as fear, anxiety or crying. So pain is also associated with fear, anxiety and crying sensation. And limbic system is responsible for body's affective means emotional qualities of reward, punishment, aversive drives and fear reactions to pain, which I have already given the example. Third is, this is about the perception of the brain, perception of the pain. Next is the reaction. I have said that there are two reactions. One is physiological, another is behavioral. So first we will see the physiological response or the physiological reaction to the pain. So initially there will be sympathetic stimulation and it occurs in pain of low to moderate intensity and superficial pain. Sympathetic nerves are sympathetic processes stimulated. That means the heart rate will rise, you know, the respiration will be increased. Then next is parasympathetic stimulation. If pain is very severe and it is unrelenting, means it is not relieved, then and it is very deep, especially the pain of the visceral organs, then the parasympathetic stimulation occurs. When parasympathetic stimulation occurs, it causes pallor. Pallor means paleness, muscle tension, heart rate and BP falls, decreases, rapid irregular breathing, nausea, vomiting, weakness and exhaustion. So this is the parasympathetic stimulation occurs due to deep pain and pain which is not relieved. But one thing you have to remember, in the note I have written that except in cases of severe acute pain, most people reach to a level of adaptation in which physical signs return to normal. That means after some time the patient adapts to pain and then the physical signs, that means the BP, the heart rate or the excessive sweating, these all will disappear and these the vital parameters will return to normal. This is a state of adaptation to the pain. Then second reaction is the behavioral reaction. So behavioral reaction, Meinhardt and McCaffrey, they have described three phases of pain experience. One is anticipation, second is sensation, third is the aftermath. Behavioral reaction is divided into three stages or three phases. One is anticipation, second is sensation, third is aftermath. So anticipation means we are anticipating that pain will occur. That means we are having intuition or we are beforehand we are thinking that the pain sensation will be there. So anticipation, sometimes it will heighten the pain perception and sometimes it will reduce the anxiety. Both ways it is necessary, as well as sometimes it will cause increased sensation of pain. Then next is sensation. Sensation means it occurs when actual pain is felt. The way to express pain is differ in different persons. Tolerance to pain is the extent to which the patient is or the person is unwilling to accept the pain sensation. Then pain threatens the physical and psychological well-being. There is often seen that the nurse is willing to attend to a person with high level of pain tolerance. Some people, they are highly tolerant to pain. Some people, they are very intolerant to pain. So pain is also a subjective sensation. But remember that if the patient is not expressing the pain, that means the client is not experiencing pain. That is a false belief. So the nurse should communicate clearly regarding the pain. The knowledge of the nurse regarding illness help the nurses to anticipate that the client will be in pain. For example, a person just after surgery will definitely have pain. Some have more toleration to the pain, others are less tolerant to pain, but definitely just after the surgical procedure there will be pain. So the knowledge is required so that accordingly the interventions will be planned. Then next behavioral reaction is the aftermath. It occurs when the pain is reduced or stopped. Aftermath of pain. That means the crisis is now over. Actually, pain is a crisis. Now, let us see how the pain is characterized. There are two main categories of pain. One is acute pain, another is chronic pain. When the pain is called as acute, when it is less than 6 months duration. Usually response to a specific trauma forms the basis of danger and warnings and subsequent learning. So that further any type of this type of episode should be is avoided. So acute pain always is accomplished with learning to prevent any further episode of pain. Now characteristics of acute pain are: it is protective, it is of short duration, there is limited tissue damage and emotional response, and it will ultimately resolve with or without treatment. Patient is very anxious and expect to get relieved quickly, and there is willingness by the health team members also to treat the acute pain aggressively, whereas chronic pain is not with same enthusiasm. The chronic pain is not attended. It is a serious threatening to a client's recovery by resulting in prolonged hospitalization, increased risk of complications from immobility, and delayed rehabilitation. Efforts are directed towards teaching and motivating client for self-care becomes useless. It is self-limiting, so patient has insight that the pain will end. Second is the chronic pain. Chronic pain is lasting for more than 6 months, exists beyond the time for normal organic healing. Now the pain will begin to impair other functions. Also, the patient will experience helplessness, hopelessness, and most of the patients who are in chronic pain, they are in depression. They will show the sign of depression. So what are the signs of depression? Lethargic, sleep disturbance, weight loss. They may quit work, they may quit from the work and adapt a self-imposed invalid existence. That means socially they will be isolated. So now let us see the characteristics of chronic pain. Symptoms last longer than 6 months. They are not protective, continuous or episodic, does not always have identifiable cause, few objective medical findings, there will be medication abuse also, overuse of medications, difficulty in sleeping, depression, lethargy, inability to perform the activities of daily living, unemployment, sexual dysfunction and social isolation. All the patients of chronic pain, they suffer from physical and mental exhaustion. Chronic pain always creates uncertainty of how one will feel the day from day to day. Now I will tell about, there are various categories of chronic pain. One is chronic episodic pain, that means in between some episodes of intense pain, then they are alternating with pain-free periods. For example, migraine pain, these are chronic episodic pain, tension, headache, etc. Then chronic non-cancer persistent intractable or benign pain. It is not due to any type of cancer, benign condition, not cancerous. Pain is persistent with no pain-free period. But that means continuously the person has pain although he is not having cancer. For example, low back pain, arthritis, peripheral neuropathy. These are some of the chronic non-cancer persistent pain. Then cancer pain. This is also a type of chronic pain. Malignant condition where the pain is continuous and it will increase in the intensity as the disease progresses. Then pain by inferred pathological process, that means some damage has occurred, nociceptive pain. For example, somatic, that means in the joint, bone, muscle, skin or connective tissue. In these areas, the pain sensation is localized and throbbing, whereas the visceral pain are due to anoxemia, that means less oxygen supply, necrosis of that particular area, any obstruction, due to either tumor or stones, etc. Then tumor, stone in the GI tract, angina, kidney stone, etc. Prostatic pain. These are all the type of visceral pains. Let us see the characteristic feature of true visceral pain. It is dull, deep, not well defined, and differently described by the patients. It is accompanied by a sense of malaise. Sometimes it is difficult to locate the type of pain. It tends to radiate. It induces strong autonomic reflex phenomena. Like I had said earlier also, that when the pain is very deep, it will stimulate the parasympathetic nerve end of parasympathetic stimulation, which causes sweating, decrease in heart rate, BP. Then the second type of chronic pain is the neuropathic pain. Neuropathic pain occur due to the dysfunction of the peripheral nervous system or the central nervous system, or impaired regulation of the autonomic nervous system also. These are mostly seen in cases of diabetes, alcoholism, chronic alcoholism, GB syndrome, etc. Now I will tell about the factors which influence pain. First is age. That means developmental difference among the children and older adults can influence how the children and older adults react to the pain experience. For children, vocabulary not developed, not able to express properly. Toddlers, preschoolers not able to recall the explanations. They are not able to remember the explanations about the pain or associate pain as experiences that occur in various situations. Then in case of infants, the preterms are more sensitive to pain. Term neonates have same sensitivity to pain as the older infant and children. Behavioral cues, other behaviors associated with the pain are necessary to understand the pain in infant. And physiological reactions are necessary to understand the pain. And infants are sensitive to drugs, so we have to titrate the dose carefully. And not overdose of drug is not recommended in infants. And in older adults, due to aging, some older people, they think that pain is a part of pain. With age, the perception of pain does not get dull or less perception to pain. That means with age, you cannot say that the pain sensation will diminish. Older adults, they normally underreport pain because it is something that they have to live with. They are thinking like that. Or complaints, normally they are ignored by the caregiver and children. Then there is fear of loss of independence, so they don't tell that they are having pain. Then fear of any unpleasant diagnostic procedures, fear of having any serious illness or death. So they do not tell about the actual pain. They use various terms like discomfort, or right, like they are feeling discomfort. Then next factor is, first was the age. Second is fatigue. Fatigue will heighten, it will increase the pain perception. And normally there is no gender difference in perception to the pain, although some studies are showing that less morphine is required by the females as compared to males for pain relief. Then genes. Genetic information passed on by the parents shows increased sensitivity to pain and determines the pain threshold or pain tolerance. Then neurological function, any factor that interrupts or influences the normal pain reception or perception will affect the patient's awareness of the pain. This is also important factor. Then next factor is a social factor, attention, previous experience. Distraction is associated with diminished pain response.
sometimes it is helpful. At less attention when it is given, it will reduce pain sensation for a very short duration. Like then previous experience, person learned from previous painful experience, it can either increase the anxiety or it will help the person to take to cope better by taking necessary action beforehand. Then family and social support. Social factors. The next point is the family and social support. If it is present, it will reduce the stress of pain. Then spiritual factor. It is also a factor that has both physical and emotional component. Then next is the psychological factors. Anxiety increases perception of pain. Coping style, this is second psychological factor. A supportive family, exercise, singing, religious belief, these are better coping styles. Saying prayer, reading scriptures, these will give inner strength to cope more effectively with the pain. Then cultural factors in the psychological factor itself. In cultural factors, the people respond to the pain in different ways. Different meaning and attitude are associated with pain in different age groups. In some culture, expression of the pain should be present, whereas in others, it is not so. So I will conclude today up to this, and then I will continue the topic in the next class. So thank you, students.